ever seen the world end in the glimmer of her sight. As the eyes begin to open and the blindness meets the light. If you have so say, I see the world in light.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for joining us. We are Key to Faith Ministries, and we're on YouTube, KTF Church. Please tune in every Sunday morning. We're also at the Fox Hollow every other Sunday if you'd like to join us live. We love you. We appreciate you. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for tuning in. We are very, very grateful to you. I hope you've been enjoying the Word. We've really been structuring it. We're just going through 1st and 2nd Peter. I hope you've been enjoying that. They're amazing epistles. They're practical epistles. There's so many things. There's a whole part of the epistle that we're going to be talking about, life and marriage and family. It's going to be really, really powerful. I'm so excited about what's coming up in the days ahead. So keep tuning in. We hope to continue to inspire you, to teach you, to reveal God's will, to be practical for you. God has so much for you. I hope you believe that God has so much for you. It's almost unbelievable, if I could say that, but we're people of faith, so we do believe in the goodness of God, and we do believe in all that He has for us, and it is powerful. So we've been talking about Jesus as our example. We've been talking a little bit about our culture last week. We talked about how our culture is, we are responding to one another in a very harsh, unkind, cruel way. And that's not the example that Jesus left us, that we are to speak the truth, but in love. We are to be people of grace. In other words, we are giving people a love that they cannot earn and they don't deserve. Come on, they didn't earn it. Listen, we're giving it free, just like God gave you salvation free, but it cost Him a terrible price, His own Son on the cross. You've been forgiven, so you've got to forgive other people. We're going to live in that example. We're going to watch our speech. We're going to watch how we treat people. We're going to watch how we talk to people, even people who are mistaken, are in error. Come on, that is what the gospel is about, that we give people grace. What they don't deserve and couldn't earn, we are going to give them grace. And it is to... the Bible said the goodness of God leads to repentance, a change of heart, a change of mind, to follow God and to come out of a destructive way of life. And it's very, very powerful. So may I just pray with you. Father, we just thank you for what you have for us today. I'm excited about today. I'm excited about the word. I'm excited about the presence of God that's with everyone that is listening. I believe that, God. I thank you for the people in our church that have been praying for these broadcasts, have been praying for every message. Father, I pray you set people free, that you deliver them, and you bring them into an intimate and deep relationship with you, and we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So we really talked a lot about Jesus being an example, and He is our example. And Jesus is such a powerful example of how to live in relationship with God. He's a powerful example how to live in a relationship with God. Jesus continually said, nevertheless, not my will, but your will. Why would you surrender your life to the will of somebody else? Because their will is better for you than the will you may have for yourself. God, who knows everything, created the universe, who infinitely loves and cares for you, knows what is best for you. When I was a young child, and even as a teenager, I had a little bit of a rebellious streak, and I thought I knew what was good for me, and all I did was get myself into trouble and hurt myself because I didn't trust that my parents knew something that I didn't know, that they had a wisdom that I didn't have. I lived out of my impetuousness, and rather than paying attention to their years of experience having gone through it. Thank God, God has never gone through sin. His character is perfect. His love is perfect. He does the right thing, but He teaches us how to live a life free. I love the word freedom. It's so powerful. The Bible said, whom the Son, Jesus, sets free is free indeed. Jesus said, the word is truth and the truth will set you free. God is about living in freedom. So have this relationship with God. Jesus lived in an intimate, loving relationship with God. He trusted God. He believed God's word. He knew God's word was true. He gave God's word to people. When the word is received, it brings blessing. When the word is believed, it delivers us from the oppression and consequences of wrong choices and evil desires and evil actions and hurting other people. In a relationship with God, it begins with forgiveness. We have offended God. We have ruined His kingdom. We've hurt other people that He loves. So we need forgiveness. Come on, can you get practical? God, I don't believe people don't think they need forgiveness or that they've done something wrong and they're just going to go scot-free like our God. Oh, well, whatever. No, there's justice in the kingdom. Last week, we talked about people suffering under injustice. They want payment for the injustice that's been done to them. So does God. And Jesus died on the cross so that you can have, so that that payment for your injustice was paid for by him. Otherwise, you'd have to suffer. He took your place. Come on, I know every time you hear me, I'm kind of preaching that kind of gospel, but it is true. But once you have that freedom to be forgiven, you can forgive others. You can give people grace. What they didn't deserve and they didn't earn, which is your love, your care, your concern, your instruction, come on, your wisdom, your experience. Come on, we keep loving people no matter what they do, because really they're on the road to their own destruction. We are not trying to be vengeful, unkind, cruel, defend ourselves. God's our defender. They're on their way to trouble. We're already been set free. So, you know, so Jesus left a powerful example how to live in a relationship with God. That was to walk in his will, to walk in his word, to receive his spirit. When Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just give you forgiveness of sins. He sent his spirit. He was resurrected from the dead. Do you believe that? The Bible says, if you believe he rose from the dead, God will save you, because that spirit that rose Christ from the dead, it says, will live in you. I can't explain it. I used to teach it in youth group by putting several drops of dye in the water and say, look, the dye is like the Holy Spirit, and our spirit is like this glass, and somehow he mingles with it. There are spiritual truths. We can make some natural examples, but we're never going to understand it until we get to heaven and see how the work of the Spirit really works. But God mingles with us, and he gives us power over that. You know, it's just amazing. So Jesus was a powerful example, and to treat other people, especially those that don't know God. Yep, that's our job, to tell people how to treat one another, even those that don't know God. Look, the word is universal. The word of God is good for everybody. The word will teach the ignorant and the learned, the intelligent and the not so intelligent, the rich, the poor, come on, whoever you are, it will teach us how to treat one another. The problem is, it's not just a moral book with a moral code and a moral ethic. You know, listen, you can't live it. You need power. You need power within. Your heart won't let you live it. Your heart, the Bible said, is desperately wicked. Again, I'm just going to go back to some theology. We all need it. You need it. I need it. We need the Holy Spirit. We can't live this word without the Holy Spirit. That means we need Jesus, because Jesus gives the Holy Spirit. Without Jesus, you can't get the Holy Spirit. Without Jesus, all the sins of your past are not forgiven, because he paid for them. Come on. Christianity is magnificently logical and magnificently powerful. The Bible said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is Christ in you that will give you the power to treat your fellow man right. It's the truth made alive in you, not just in your head, but you know that you have to live this out. So Jesus will teach us how not only to live our best life, but how to treat other people. And you know, so much of your eternal destiny depends on how you treated other people and how you treated God. Some people treat God like they treat people that they hate. And it's no wonder, you know, that the world is the mess that it is in. So with God, nothing is impossible. You can begin this journey of sanctification. What does that mean? That's a big word, sanctification. It means the good things of God is pushing out the bad things that are in us. God is filling you to overflowing what's good and what's bad. There was a great story that a man told one time. He said, you know, a man fell into an inky black river and drowned. And they got him out of the river. They rescued him. But the man was still dying. And they continued to pump his chest. And they said this: we saved him, we got him out of the river, but then we had to get the river out of him. You know, and that's what God is doing. God saved us from eternal judgment. God saved us from hell. God saved us from being like the devil himself. God saved us from evil. Evil living in us. Evil alive. Evil controlling us. He saved us from that. Jesus' death on the cross did that. But then the Holy Spirit comes in, and he not only sets us free from the evil consequences, he sets us free from the evil within. It gets pushed out when the Holy Spirit comes in. We got to get the river out. We got to get that inky black river out. And Jesus does that by the Holy Spirit and by truth. How powerful is this? This is so powerful. Jesus said, nothing is impossible with God. Yes, you can live above your natural man, your fallen nature. You can live above your vengeance, your anger, your bitterness, your selfishness, your cruelty. Come on, whatever is your poison, come on, you can live above it because the Holy Spirit is in you. Jesus never answered someone to be right, to win an argument, to prove them wrong. What his words were to teach people about his love and to call them to eternal life. So we're not speaking to people to correct them, to be right, to be politically correct or politically incorrect or whatever is your poison. We're speaking to them to tell them that there is a way that God has called us to live that sets us free from pain and suffering in this world. So last week we really talked about watching our words and how we speak to one another. The spirit that we carry, is it angry, is it bitter, is it vengeful? Do we want evil towards other people? And here we get an incredible practical example. It's in 2 Peter 2:24. Let's just read it together. And a servant of the Lord, that's you and I, we are servants of God, must not be quarrelsome. We're not in this thing to win an argument. It's not about being argumentative. It's about sharing the truth of God's word and then letting it go. There are times you're just going to have to let it go. You have to let the truth have its perfect work. You're going to have to let the truth settle. Some people hate the truth because it will convict them. We're going to read about that in a minute. But must be kind to everyone, able to teach and forbearing. You know, give people space. Just a spoonful of medicine. Come on. You know, we want to give people the whole jar, you know. We want the people who, listen, I am still in the process of being set free from evil thoughts and desires that rage through me every single day. There's still a war going on in my soul. There's still this part of me that is so self-absorbed, so selfish, so self-willed, that self is at the center rather than love and God. And that I'm being delivered from that every single day. And you can be too. But you say, I don't want to be delivered from that, or I won't really be me. Oh, you'll be the best you that you could ever be. Because God is talking about freedom from the things that hinder you, reaping consequences that you've earned, but instead being free, living in the world above those consequences, being a victorious person. So listen to this. He must gently reprove. Say no, that's wrong. Correct. Say this is what's right. You decide, but this is what's right. It's on you. I delivered the mail. Now you have to open it and read it and believe it. And reprove those who oppose him in the hope that God may grant them repentance, turning away from sin to doing what God's will says is the right thing to do. To acknowledge, leading to a knowledge of the truth. Then they will come to their senses, and escape the snare of the devil who has taken them captive to his will. Well, there's a whole lot of theology in that, you know. I wish I can tell you that all the evil thoughts and desires that we think and have are just from ourselves, but they're not. There is a culture war going on. There is a battle between good and evil going on. It is true. It is in the world. Why did Jesus come? Because there was a battle between good and evil, and he's calling us to choose a side, to choose God's side, to choose God's will. And when we do, we don't hurt ourselves. We don't hurt other people. We don't ruin the kingdom of God. We don't destroy the world. We don't destroy our souls. We are not born just for this world. We're born with the spirit. We're made in the image and likeness of God. People that are lost and fallen are just materialistic. Everything in the world is the only thing that matters. But it's not. It's more the spiritual things that matter, how we treat other people, that we do good, that we do what's right. Those are the things that really, really matter to God. He must gently reprove those who oppose him in the hope that God will grant them repentance, Then they will come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil who has taken them captive at his will. Not all the thoughts and imaginations of our heart have just come from us. We have been seeded by the enemy. We have been seeded. God has an eternal family, but we have been seeded by an enemy. Jesus tells a story about a field that he sowed his seed into, and an enemy came in through tares, which is weeds in the middle of the night, trying to choke out the good seed. The devil wants to choke out the good in you. He doesn't want you to rise and to take your place, to have victory. You know, love is the ultimate triumph. You realize that, right? While all this evil is in the world and you choose love, to love God, to love people, to love what is right, it is the ultimate triumph. We're going to be talking about that. It is the ultimate triumph that you're no longer captive to those desires and motives that may not be of God, that may not be pleasing to God. I love it. I love it. There are so many things that God has for you. So in Acts 26, 17, Apostle Paul was called to the ministry. Listen to these words. I'm sending you to them. I don't want to go to them. They're angry with me. They don't agree with me. They don't like me. They don't care. It doesn't matter. I'm sending you anyway because I love them. And I need a messenger that will go. I need a messenger that understands the triumph of love. I need a messenger that will go, that even when they do injurious things to them, I don't even know if that's a word, if they injure you, that you'll not take revenge and vengeance, that you won't hate them, but you realize it's their broken, blind spiritual condition. Keep going. I'm sending you to them. I'm sending you to them with the triumph of love that reigns in your heart to open their eyes. To open their eyes to what? To see the truth, to see God's kingdom, to see that there's a battle of kingdoms. There's a battle of lords. There's a battle between good and evil. It's raging in the world. If you cannot see it, then you are not seeing anything at all. Then you're the blindest of the blind. It's not about ideologies. It's about good and evil. It's about good and evil as defined by God. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. These are massive truths. Your life is more. Life is more than what you see in the natural world. There is a spiritual dimension and a spiritual war and a battle between good and evil. And you're a willing or an unwilling participant. But you're in it. And there's the triumph of love that God is putting in you to continue to love people so you can continue to help them no matter how unkind, how unjust, how cruel, how selfish, how mean, how self-centered, how blind. You keep going. I'm sending you to them because I love them as much as I loved you when you were in your mess. Yes, God is coming to you and he loves you in your mess so that they may turn from darkness to light. There's that word repentance again. Dark, gone, and past. So I have to keep saying that. Yes, yes. To turn you from evil to good, from seeing what's evil to seeing what's good, powerful. And from the power of Satan to the power of God. The word Satan means adversary. To the adversary of what's good, to the adversary of what's right, to the adversary of God, to the adversary of selfishness, self-will. The devil doesn't care what happens to you and I. And he sows that in other people. He doesn't care. He doesn't care if you're destroyed. He doesn't care if you're ruined. He doesn't care if you're happy. He doesn't care about your destiny. He doesn't respect you as a human being. He thinks you're nothing. But God says, I'm sending you. And you better have a different desire and attitude than the devil because I love them. I want them to know that they're made in my image and likeness. I want them to know that I've come to restore them to the truth. I've come to get them to see their blindness. I've come to have them enter the war, to not suffer the consequences, to get on the right side. Powerful. To open their eyes from darkness to light, from the power of their adversary. From the adversary. The Garden of Eden talks about an adversary that came into the world, deceived them, lied about God's intentions, God's good nature, his intentions towards people. He gave them another standard of wrong and right that would meet every selfish, self-willed desire at their destruction and the destruction of others, because that's who the devil is. He is so selfish and self-willed. He doesn't care who he hurts, and it's contrary to the nature of God. For Jesus left heaven and the glory of heaven and the majesty of heaven and the authority of heaven and the power of heaven, disrobed of it all, became a man and suffered in your place. From selfishness to selfless. From self-willed to God's will. Jesus, the perfect example. From loving those who crucified him. His last words were, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It's incredible. Incredible. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but possess eternal life. That they may receive forgiveness of sins. This is what it's all about. You have made mistakes. Oh my God. The hardest thing I've ever had to do is to get people to own up. Yes, I've sinned against God. I've sinned against man. I've done the wrong thing. Oh my God, cry out for forgiveness. In this day and age, it's almost impossible for people to think that they've ever done anything wrong or that God grades on this big curve. He doesn't grade on a curve. He grades on perfection and no one meets it. So Jesus came to meet the perfection of God so you can be forgiven. What a gift. It's called righteousness, right standing, forgiven. When Jesus died on the cross and he paid for your sins, you were justified just as if I had never sinned. Come on, these are great gifts from God. It's a second chance. It's a chance to live right, to do right, to get on the right side of history, to join the army of God, to join the people of God, to be free of judgment and of sin and of the curse of the law, the consequences. Come on, it's amazing. An inheritance among those sanctified by faith in me. Wow, this word sanctified, there it is again. It's being set free from the power of sin. That's all it means. If sin has a power, it has a lure. Look at temptation. I tell you what, you can't look at pornography without having sexual desires that are perverse, that are evil, that are wrong. Of course, you know, sex was designed for the ecstasy of an intimate love with one person. Yeah, it was supposed to be that good, that perfect, that you never have to look outside that relationship. It was a union of ecstasy, of perfect love all the time. But see, those other desires come and they're flooded in. And that's what the devil does. He opens the door. He creates temptation and wants us to walk through it and oppose God. And all it does is create heartache. What a terrible thing to disrespect the image and likeness of God that's in every human being. God so wants that restored in us, that we would love him and that we would love one another and realize that's the greatest gift that he ever gave us, was a nature like him, a character like him. And character brings blessing. Character brings hope. Character brings faith. In an inheritance among those sanctified by me, letting go of what's wrong and doing what's right. That's what it means to be sanctified. But how do we do that? By having faith in Jesus. By having faith in Jesus. I promise you, he will satisfy you. Oh my God, the great lie of the enemy is you'll never be satisfied. Let me tell you something. In this world, that thing that looks like satisfaction is really an apple with a worm in it. It's really drinking from a well that's continually being poisoned until it kills you. The water may taste sweet. It may feel like it's refreshing you, but it's slowly killing you, sapping the life. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it much more abundantly. Jesus said, I am the well of living water. Drink from me. So powerful. The quality of Jesus' spirit drew people to him. That spirit of love, that spirit of grace, that spirit of truth, that spirit of righteousness. How could he be all those things? Because he's God in human flesh and he's come for us. The last act of his life, like I said, was to die so unselfishly. It drew the world to himself as an example of perfect love. That's the example Jesus set for us. Not to hate, not to get even, not to wish God's judgment. Oh my God, there are some people that hurt me. I said, God. And God said, no, I don't want you to pray for judgment. I don't want you to pray that they will be put out of my presence forever, that they'll never be forgiven. That makes you horrible. God said, I want you to love them and to forgive them and to pray for them. This is the example. This is what Peter is telling us. Jesus is this example. I, 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 I want to read the foundation scriptures to you one more time. For you were called to this kind of life. You were called to this kind of life. You were called to this kind of life. One that loves in spite of what other people do. He did no wrong deed. Treated people right no matter what. No evil word. He spoke right no matter what other people said to him. The anointed word suffered for us and left us an example so that we could follow in his steps. We're following in his steps so we don't reap the judgment of God. We're going to do right. They're going to reap the judgment of God. We're trying to rescue them. They don't know it. They don't care. They think we're opposing them. No, we're only opposing them to grant them repentance, to unensnare them, as I just read, from the devil's taking them captive at his will. When he was verbally abused, he didn't return the abuse. When he suffered, he didn't make threats to cause suffering in return. We don't want people to suffer in return because of what they've done to us. We're trying to save them from themselves. Instead, he trusted that all would be put right by the one who is just when he judges. They're going to face the judgment. They may go through their whole merry life and nothing ever goes wrong and everything seems to work out and they're doing evil to everybody, but they're going to face the judgment seat of Christ. Don't gloat. And don't worry about what will happen, because God will keep you and protect you. You can ask for freedom from those who do evil to you. He took on our sins in his body when he died on the cross. So being dead to sin, we can live for righteousness. So we have to do what's right, and the Holy Spirit's going to help us. And not only that, the same way Jesus forgave you, he wants to forgive them. And you want, even for your enemies, that they would be forgiven by God. Because to spend eternity out of the presence of God, it's the worst punishment that you could ever have. I wouldn't wish that on anybody. My worst enemy. So as the saying goes, and through his wounds we're healed. We were forgiven. Through his sacrifice, you're forgiven. You were healed. God wants to heal them too. For there was a time when you were like sheep that wandered away, but now you've returned to the great shepherd, the guardian of your souls. I just want to read this one last thing to you. It's so powerful. John 12, 44 through 47, Jesus shouted to the crowds. Jesus is impassioned now. If you trust me, you are trusting not only in me, but also God that sent me. For when you see me, you are seeing the one who sent me. We're seeing everything that God is and everything that God wants to do. Rescue you to be like Jesus. Perfect love, perfect righteousness. Perfect faithfulness. We're going to talk about those in the next broadcast. I've come as a light to shine in the dark world, the truth, so that all who put their trust in me will no longer remain in the dark, in the error, in the foolishness of their ways, in their selfishness, in their anger, in their bitterness, in their vengefulness, in their unforgiveness, in the suffering that they cause to themselves and to others. I will not judge those who hear me but don't obey me, for I've come to save the world and not to judge. Come now while there's time, while God is pursuing you. This broadcast is a calling, a come to God. It's God pursuing you. It's no accident you're watching this. It's no accident that you turn this on. There are thousands of stories of providence as a pastor I hear every single day. God calling, God drawing, and people not seeing, not knowing, because the selfishness that's in them has blinded them to the mercy and the grace of God. But today I'm asking you, come while the season is here. I look outside and everything is green. Come while the season is green, while God's moving. Read God's word. Let it draw you to God's love. Let it instruct you, strengthen you, and deliver you. Meditate on the life of Jesus. I want to pray with you. Say, Father, I believe today is my day. Today, I want to be forgiven. I receive Jesus' death on the cross. Today, I want power over the evil that's trying to control my life. So I believe Jesus rose from the dead. Say it with me. Jesus, send me your Holy Spirit to live above the anger, the vengeance, the bitterness, the sins. Jesus, send your Holy Spirit into my life to help me live above the seasons, those sins of vengeance and evil and selfishness. And Jesus, help me to love you, to love other people. Amen. If you prayed that, you prayed the most important prayer of your life. You made the most decision of your life. You have passed from time into eternity. Jesus said that you've gone from death to life, from judgment to favor, from sin to forgiveness. It's a wonderful thing. We love you. Thank you for tuning in. We'll talk to you soon. God bless you.
Have you ever seen the wonder in the glimmer of your sight? As the eyes begin to open, so say, I see the world in light, I see the world in wonder, I see the world in light, bursting in living color, I see the world you make, and I'm walking in the light. Have you ever seen the wonder in the air of second? Jesus way.